So, Mr. Rodriguez, it's really a pleasure to have you here in Ljubljana, Slovenia, and as one of the most competent, we would like to ask you, what are your views on the perspective of Eurozone? What are the alternatives? It's a question that was discussed today here on this round table. Please give to our audience some of the views from your aspect that is broader than others.
Well, I'm coming from Brussels, but I'm in a tour of capitals in Europe with very important debates on the future of the Eurozone. But I must tell you that the debate we could have today in Ljubljana was very high level, very important to feed in the decisions in Brussels. Let me tell you that we are moving in two tracks. The first one is adopting measures which are really urgent to have the crisis under control. I think recently the most important one was adopted by the European Central Bank. It was decided to provide unlimited capacity of buying bonds in the financial markets in order to stabilize spreads if this is needed. So this has a bit calmed down the pressure we were in before summertime, but we cannot say that the crisis is overcome, far from this, because we have a problem of public debt, which is still there, particularly in some member states. And we need to have efforts coming from these member states to rebalance their budgets, but you also need to have strong instruments at European level to bring down these spreads, so the costs of financing. That's why we have now a permanent mechanism for financial stability, which is there. But that's why we are even going farther, discussing possible role for euro bonds, so partial issuance of public debt. Of course, these will not come soon, because we cannot only move in this direction if member states accept to have better coordination and better surveillance of their national budgets. So when we accept these, then we can have the conditions to move in this direction of Eurobonds. But let me tell you that even this is not enough to overcome the crisis and to reduce the burden of the public debt. The last important point is to have higher growth and more investment, good investment, in the good direction, in the areas with future in Europe and in each member state, because this is really the central solution we to have. We need to make sure that our companies, our banks, are investing in the new areas of activities which can create better jobs, new kind of jobs in Europe. So I would say that this is, in the end, the kind of solution we need to have.
So are we close to a consensus among the member states about the maybe more active role of from the centralized European level, considering the questions of course, on the one side of the bonds, the central bank, and other policies that should be maybe adopted to be able to, of course, answer or respond to this really questions that are quite needed to be responded as quick as possible toward them?
Well, to be very frank, I think we cannot say that we are close, because this is really quite big reform of the economic and monetary union. But at least there is an important progress, because it was recognized that we are confronted with a crisis which is a systemic crisis, not only a crisis of some particular countries, even this is exist. Second point, we are now working for a comprehensive solution where we need to have, fiscal discipline, but also more investment and growth. And more than that, we need to have effective policies for convergence in the European Union. And I believe this is particularly important for Slovenia because it is a more recent member state. And we need to recall that the promise of European integration is to count on a large single market, to count on a strong single currency, but also to count on effective policies to foster economic and social convergence in the European Union. So it's always important to recall that this makes part of the deal, which should be there to have a successful European integration.
And what would you suggest to Slovenian decision makers, considering especially how to stabilize the financial situation? Maybe also one of the questions that are really present right now about the possible referendum on how to manage and run the still mostly and majority state-owned parts of the companies, of the most important companies, and also other questions about the, let's say, banking system that should be capitalized, or in which direction would you suggest the Slovenian decision makers also
I must tell you that I'm not here to intervene in Slovenian internal politics. So my role is more to provide information and updated information about the European framework. So and to improve the relationship between Slovenia and the decisions being taken at European level. I can give an example. In 2 weeks' time, we'll have an important European Council in November in Brussels, which will take decisions on the community budget for the next years. And Slovenia needs to come with a very clear position on the way to use structural funds as much as possible in favor of Slovenia preferences and needs. So this is the next stage. But then in December, we'll have this general discussion on the future of economic and monetary union. And I would say that a country like Slovenia can play a very important role by saying that if we want to have an economic and monetary union with a real sound future, sustainable future, we need to have fiscal discipline, but also growth and effective instruments to support economic convergence. If we don't converge on competitiveness and better standards, social and environmental standards, it's very difficult for the Eurozone to have a sustainable future on the long term.
Mm-hmm. No, I was just asking you for your opinion or your attitude. I know that you cannot give the advices for our decision makers, but I was asking you about, maybe since you are well informed about these questions, what your suggestion would be, and as far, because these discussions are here pretty intensive in Slovenia about also possible intervention of Troika, of the help that might be needed for Slovenia pretty soon. I mean, can you give us a comment?
Yes, the comment I can give you, also taking into account lessons from other countries, is that of course, the ideal solution would be for Slovenia to avoid Troika intervention, counting on the new developments which are taking place in different areas regarding possible role of the European Central Bank, the need to have a better use of the instruments to rescue banks. All these should be used by Slovenia. But in any case, Slovenia will deal with conditionality, because conditionality now is attached not only to Troika programs, but to macroeconomic surveillance, to the follow-up of the Stability and Growth Pact, to any kind of support for banks. Therefore, the key issue is what kind of conditionality. And the lesson I can present coming from other countries is that we need to have a balanced conditionality. This means that on one hand, we need to make sure that we really rebalance our public finances, for sure, but we also need to have at the same time investment in growth. So we need to have effective instruments to support investment in growth and job creation. Because this is important as such, but also because without growth, it's very difficult to keep the deficits and the debt under control.
Mm-hmm. Just one more question regarding the European level of taking care of or rights of also minority or so to say shareholders that are retail shareholders and investors and the legislation that is preparing not just considering MiFID but also maybe some audit reform and reports. And I mean, there is quite a lot going on right now at the level of European Commission and also European Parliament for the reforms and new regulation, considering the questions of investors, not just institutional investors and the industry, but also regarding the rights and taking care for the rights of retail investors, minority individual investors. What is maybe your comment on these processes?
Well, this is one of the major lessons of the financial crisis started in 2007-2008, is that we need to have clear rules to reestablish confidence between those who save resources and those who use these resources to invest. So we need much clearer rules, because otherwise the small investor, which is really needed, because this is a good behavior in Europe, is confronted with a lot of uncertainty. So what we need is to come back to rules of responsible lending and responsible borrowing. And we need to make sure that those who save, they can rely on the future of their effort. So the best way to give value to their savings is to create good conditions for good investments. So banks and the financial markets are there to perform this role. Their role is not exactly speculation. Their role should be to make sure that savings are channeled in the right direction to get real value, and like that the effort of the small shareholder can be really respected.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad to hear that you also recognize the importance of individual and the retail investors and shareholders in Europe, since I mean, we organized just a month ago, as I informed you and you're aware of, the largest meeting of investors and shareholders on a world scale here in Ljubljana. Also adopted Ljubljana declaration about the association that in Europe now with regarding European Federation of Users of Financial Services, which will take care of this broader part of the question. So I'm very glad to hear that you are also informed about it. I can feel that we have, so to say, also strong supporter about maybe one of the most important questions that also this association is dealing with. And one of the topics on our today international conference was also if there is a possibility, because one of the also most important questions in Europe is reform of the pension system. How you see a possibility that capital markets should be revitalized via pension reform, of course, also considering individual investors as the ones who should choose the capital markets for their pensions and maybe healthcare system and all the reforms that are right now also discussion on the European level and on the level of the member states. Is there any, I mean, also, or are there any alternatives of different views and aspects from the point of European Commission regarding these questions, and maybe some solutions that are in the process of preparation?
Yes, I think there is an important idea which should be developed, is that pension funds need to count on sound priorities to invest in, because they have the big responsibility of managing the saving efforts of millions of Europeans. So pension funds need to have a clear opportunity of sound investments. Therefore, we should have a sound but ambitious plan for investments in Europe, with choices of future, making sure that pension funds can rely on that to get their fair share of value. From my viewpoint, in order to put together pension funds on the one hand and the good investment plans in Europe, a third piece can help, which is to have this instrument called Eurobonds. Because if you have Eurobonds, based on national but also joint guarantees, Eurobonds can become a very reliable financial product. A financial product which should be interesting for European savers, but I must tell you also for many of the international partners of the European Union. And by the way, I just came from Beijing, and the message I got there is that Europe should move in this direction to create a large market of Eurobonds, because China will be a buyer of these Eurobonds. China don't want to depend so much only on a dollar as a reserve currency. So I think that this is a quite bold initiative. But I'm pretty sure that it will be very important to provide sound investments for pension funds.
I'm very glad to hear, but as you already explained to us, unfortunately, we are not very close to... I mean,
even I must say that we could step up the discussion, because in parallel with these urgent measures, now we have on the table of the European Council a discussion on comprehensive plan for the economic and monetary union for the first time, and key decisions can be taken in December, and one of decisions has to do with Eurobonds and the political conditions for that. So something can happen. We don't know, but something can happen.
Yeah. Would you be so courageous to predict in what kind of, are we talking about years, months, decades?
This was exactly what I told, is nobody can predict the future in general, and more, and now more than ever, because this is a very complex crisis with a lot of uncertainties. But there is something I can tell you, because I've been involved in preparing European Council meetings for the last 12 years, is that all of a sudden, because the crisis is pushing in this direction, the EU is taking important decisions. We were saying that they were impossible 1 year ago. If you think about, for instance, these recent instruments launched by the European Central Bank, this is important and positive surprise. So all of a sudden, we can again have bold decisions. At least they are already on the table, which is an important progress.
But as far as I can see, you are an optimist, still you have strong optimistic views on the processes?
Yes, I'm an optimistic person, but I'm also really aware of divergences. Perhaps not on the idea of one day Eurozone using Eurobonds. I think this will come. The divergences are about the when and with which conditions. So we are in this point of the discussion.
Mm-hmm. So I would like to go further on and ask you about the taxation of the financial transactions and so on, and the role, let's say, of the Britain and some other states, also considering the questions of Eurobonds is one of the important questions, of course. So if you would be so kind, maybe also a short comment on
it. The British position now is a bit more clear about this, because UK has understood this is on the interests of the British economy to avoid a big crisis in the Eurozone. Because if we have a big crisis in the Eurozone, the British economy will also be hit by this crisis. So they understand that the Eurozone needs to move forward with bolder solutions. They understand this. And they would, for instance, support the idea of Eurobonds, as an example. Regarding the financial transaction tax, this is more controversial for UK, because UK thinks that they can only accept a tax like that if a tax as financial transaction tax is adopted at global level. And we are quite far from this. Mm. If you see the discussion in G20, we are quite far from seeing a financial tax adopted. That's why, more recently, in the European Union, there was the decision to move forward in this direction by using the so-called enhanced cooperation, which is so far involving 11 countries. There are still some details being discussed. Also, because some member states think they should use this tax to finance their national budgets, and others accept that some resources of this tax could also finance the community budget. Mm-hmm. So we are still fine-tuning this point of discussion.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So. Let me finish again and go back to a question about the banks and the different roles of the banks. On one side, of course, giving loans to the economy, to families, to the individuals, and on the other side, of course, this financial industry. So, I mean, are you a supporter of the idea that these two different roles of the bank should be divided with all the products that financial industry developed from in the last decades?
Yeah. In fact, I'm quite in favor. Of course, there are many details to be discussed, but. Making a more clear distinction between retail banks and investment banks can be useful. We have this distinction more clear in some countries than in others. But as you know, this is being discussed as a general principle to improve banking system in Europe.
Yeah, because so far we did not see really changes in the regulations regarding banks, and after, I mean, what happened with financial crisis, and as far as we can see now, the reasons are pretty clear. So
yes.
Why there is really no changes regarding the possible danger?
Well, because there are different interests, but frankly, I think that those who are worried about their savings in retail banks, they should be more vocal by calling for a clear separation between retail banks and investment banks in order to avoid this kind of problem we had with the financial crisis.
Mm-hmm. And of course, there are also very important also the interests on a global degree. I mean, you mentioned dollar as, of course, still a global currency, and the possibility that euro also with the euro bonds could gain regarding this matter. What you see in the future, I mean, this because here the interests are not common with the, let's say, United States and their central reserves and the national bank and so on, and let's say the role of China, of course, and also some other players on a global level.
Well, I think that it's very important to overcome this Eurozone crisis and to make the Eurozone a stable and powerful currency area. Because the planet needs the possibility of choice. So dollar remains a very important currency, and so far the reference currency. But a strong euro can create the possibility of different choices across the planet, and I think this can help the global economy as a whole. This is very clear for China. China would like to have this possibility of choice. Even, of course, in the longer term, China perhaps would like to have its own currency area, but we are quite far from this yet.
So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Of course, I would have some more questions for you, but I suppose we have been quite exact on some most important topics. So again, I mean, I'm looking forward maybe to have an opportunity to see you again in Brussels, also with our activities in European Federation of Users of Financial Services. Since I can see that your positions are very valuable also for our clearer picture about the questions and our efforts that we are dealing through the time. So I would be glad also to give from maybe point of view of the European Association or the Slovenian one, if there you find maybe a need on the or the reason, we would be glad, of course, like already, let's say, International Monetary Fund and OECD and some other missions are always coming to visit our association. So maybe in the future there will be also an opportunity to help what is our primary position to solve these problems that, of course, are our common problems, and better we cooperate, the better solution we can find, I suppose.
You can count on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. It was a quite comprehensive talk. Of course, it's always important to make a detailed follow-up of the agenda for financial regulation adopted in G20, because it's a very detailed agenda. Mm-hmm. This is moving forward in some points, but is lagging behind in others. So,
I can see.
It's important to have your stakeholders active about this.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course we will try to be, but as far as you know, I mean, on this G20 meetings, there is really not not just needed, but they would not like to see that also non-governmental associations and so on would be present on such a meetings. I'm not.
Yes, but now they are starting to open to non-governmental actors. Mm-hmm. So you should pay attention to that.
Okay, we are paying attention, and thank you for your information. Maybe is there something else that we should do? I mean, being more proactive regarding, because, you know, these are the bodies that as far as I'm aware of, don't have really their institutional shell or cover or so. I mean, there are more or less still informal meetings. Am I right? So to whom then we should approach or write or whatever?
I can't tell you. No, not in an interview.